Hi, I'm Kenny Cook, and Jennifer White has asked me to share the story of my husband and I and how God has restored our marriage. It's really kind of a long story, but I'm going to try to kind of shorten it for y'all. God is just, he is so good and he is so amazing, and I just can't say enough about that. This is his story. This is not really mine or David's story. He used us in it, but it's his story. David and I were married very young. We met and married when we were in junior high school, and that is junior high, not high school. I don't recommend that. That's not a good way to start a marriage. Way, way too early. We both thought that if we got married, that, you know, we could be our own bosses, you know, get our own place, make our own decisions, and that's just not how it works when you're that age. People don't want to give you jobs at that age. So anyway, we had a child, and we had a very rocky marriage for many years. David's a good man, and he was just young. We were both very young. We were both immature. We knew nothing about how to be married. We knew nothing really about how to be good parents. But we were good people, but we made a lot of mistakes, a lot. We fought a lot. We separated a lot. We would go back together, mainly because I was determined that my children were not going to come from a divorced home like I had. And so we would start over and over. And eventually I was just so tired of this life, and I knew that I had to give my heart to Christ. I had actually gotten saved as a child, but I was not living that life, because I'd always said that when I live for God, I'm going to live for God. I'm not going to be half in and half out. I'm not going to be a hypocrite. When I make that decision, it's going to be when I'm ready to be all in. And when I did, I was all completely in. And I thought that the way you showed God that you loved him was by doing things. You know, you taught classes, you worked the nursery, you did all these, you were at the church every single time the door opened. You did everything everybody asked for you, which in some instances is not necessarily a bad thing. We are to do good works. But when you have an unsaved husband at home, that is not really a real wise way to do that. David became very bitter and angry. You know, we had a lot of other issues, but he became very angry and even told me at one point that he was jealous of God, because I did put God above him. And our relationship with God should be first in our life when we belong to him. But it's our relationship to God. It's not church work. And David just became very frustrated with always being in second place. He was in the second place to the children, and he was second place to God. And eventually, he left. He left the children in 1989. I was very angry. I was very bitter. I was angry at David, but I was really mad at God, too, because I wondered, how in the world could this happen to someone who is devoting their life to God, who does all these good things, and who loves Christ, and who is in the Word, and, you know, how could this doesn't happen to people like me. You know, I'm a good person, I'm a good wife, and I was a good wife in many, many ways, but I was also a very complaining wife. I was an angry wife. I had brought a lot of bitterness and anger into this marriage from my childhood, things that had never been dealt with, and the Lord began to do a work in my heart. I thought David was the one that needed to be fixed and needed to be changed, but it wasn't. David did need, you know, he needed to be saved. He did need a lot of things happen in his life, but the Lord was showing me, no, I was the one. I was his child, and I was the one he was going to deal with. But we have to submit to that, and it wasn't always easy. And it was many years, a lot of crying, a lot of it was just not easy. And I was anorexic because I just couldn't eat. I was going through grief. I went through just the very depths of grief. Grief is not just losing someone through death, but it's anything that you love, that you care about, anything that you feel that you've lost, you know, whether it's a job, whether it's a marriage, a relationship, whatever. And I went through a very horrendous time of grief. But I'm telling you, the Lord just did a work in me. He was very faithful. The days that I was very brutally honest to him and would tell him, you know how I feel anyway. I'm very angry. I don't understand why myself and my children are going through this. But he was always there for me. Sometimes I was so angry, he actually had to pull his hand back some and just let me sit in it a little while. But he always came through. He always came back. He would be the father that I needed. He would be the husband that I needed. He would be the provider. He would be the counselor. He did that himself through the Holy Spirit, but he also sent many, many people into our lives during that time. Very faithful people who helped us financially and were friends and people that could be sounding boards, that I could just be who I was. I could vent my frustrations. And they always led me back to God's Word. And during this time also, God gave me a promise. I had just told him, I said, Lord, I cannot do this. David and I had separated and went back so many times. And I just said, Lord, I just can't do this anymore. I'm tired. I'm worn out. And he spoke so distinctly to my spirit. And he said, and this too shall pass. And I actually looked around to see, you know, I just felt like I heard it so real. I actually looked around to see who was in the room. And I knew it was the Holy Spirit. And he kept that promise. He reminded me, I should say, of that promise many times when I would be, usually when I was just right at the end of my rope, just thinking I can't make it anymore. I would turn the radio on and somebody would say, and this too shall pass. Or I would pick up a book or a magazine and it would, you know, it was always my reminder from a very sweet God that yes, it's hard and it's difficult, but it's okay. It's not going to always be like this. And I would cling to that. I would cling to that promise. But I also want to say, if anyone, any of you are going through this kind of problem, this kind of grief, this kind of hurt, you know, and you may not even be separated, but you may just be so frustrated in your marriage, use that time to get in your Word. Get in the Word. Because this is the only thing that's true and real. And there were so many times that I did pick up this very Bible, that I picked it up, and I would read passages out of it where he said, I will be your father, I will be your husband, I will never leave you. And I would just tell him, I don't really feel like that's true right now. I'm going to be honest. I see it, but I don't feel that it's true. But I know that it's true because it's in your Word. And you wouldn't put it in there if it wasn't true. And so I had clung to things that I didn't really feel at that time. You know, in that moment, they just didn't seem real to me. But I knew that they were. And I would just have to walk in that. And so I would really suggest anybody, just get in the Word. Use this time that you're hurting and you're lonesome for your husband or your wife or whoever, that you're going through hard times, get in the Word and ask God to give you a promise. Ask Him to give you a word. Well, one day in my quiet time, the Lord started giving me, in Isaiah, I was just like, oh my gosh, He just started giving me these scriptures. And some of them, these were, and he told me specifically that these were going to be for David's salvation. And I've got, they're right here, but I've got them here as well. Says, then you will know that I, the Lord, am your Savior, your Redeemer, and Mighty One of Jacob. And that was Isaiah 60:16. He also gave me Isaiah 60:18. But you will call your wall salvation and your gates praise. Isaiah 61:10. He said, I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for He has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in the robe of righteousness. And He showed me, when I saw those words, He spoke to me, that's for David. David's going to be saved. I just remember being so excited, and I was just waiting for the phone to ring any minute, because He also gave me Isaiah 60, where He says, I am the Lord, in its time I will do this swiftly. And I was so excited. I said, He's going to do this swiftly. This is going to happen. The phone's fixing to ring. You know, the phone rang, and that's not what it was. And a week later, and that's not what it was, you know. And I just thought, oh, Lord, I know You said it's going to be swiftly, so it's going to be pretty soon. But it didn't happen. But I had the promises. And I knew that at some point David was going to be saved. And I thought that part of that was that he was coming home. David's going to be saved, and he's coming home. Well, I hate to say this, but after 6 years of him not coming home, and during this time, I would also suggest, especially ladies, if you're going through something like this, do not try to replace with another man. If you are still married, you are still married. I did not date during this whole time because I was still a married woman. I even had Christian people tell me it was okay for me to date because, you know, I was, you know, in these circumstances and God would understand, but I was still a married woman. I did not date. I concentrated on my children because my children were hurting. And sometimes when we're hurting so bad, when we're in a bad marriage or we're just hurting from the things that are said by our spouses, we tend to forget that those children are watching and they're seeing us and they're being hurt as well. So I try to concentrate on my children at this time and try to see them through this hard time. But after 6 years, David got the divorce that I would never get because I wanted to give God every opportunity to save this marriage, if at all possible. And when he got the divorce and he remarried, so I thought, well, you know, the parts of David getting saved were still true, but as far as us getting back together, that is evidently just wasn't part of the plan. So when he got married, and that's where I would say, well, it's time, you know, it's okay for me to start looking around. My children were getting older. You know, the door is open if I want to try to find, you know, another spouse somewhere down the road. But I'm telling you, you have to be so careful as well because I knew better, but yet the enemy had a trap set, and I walked right into it, and I got right into another bad marriage. So just remember, if you leave the marriage that you're in, a lot of times you think you're leaving that marriage because you're having problems, but there's still going to be problems. You're not going to ever get away from problems. When you leave that husband, you know, you just say, I can't take it anymore. Anything short of physical abuse or whatever, then there's going to be more problems down the road. And I remarried a man who was verbally and emotionally abusive. And that was a whole nother 5.5 years of my life. But I'm telling you, even through that was a whole nother pain and a whole nother lesson. I tell you, God was so faithful even in that. He taught me so much of how he loves us when we make mistakes. You know, the worst mistakes we can ever make, he can turn on back for good if we'll just let him. And that's just a whole nother story in itself. But that marriage ended up ending. So here I was in a second divorce. And I just thought, you know, here I was, this person who was never going to be divorced, you know, like my parents were. But here I was now divorced twice. And really felt like quite a failure at this point. Well, in the process of all this, David had also gotten divorced. His wife had left him pretty much the same way he left us. He went through a period of grief. He told me later that now he finally understood what I had been through and the children had been through. And he tried to make that marriage work. He tried to go back with her and she would have nothing to do with it. And so during this time, we just kind of would see each other because of the kids. You know, we would just, I would pick our daughter up from his house or whatever. And the Lord started doing a work in David and I both. And we started seeing that he looked like he was trying to put us back together. David would have to tell his whole story because he has a whole story that's just amazing of how God began to give him dreams that he didn't think made sense. And they were through sermons. You know, David began to become softened again. I had made him very bitter and angry at God because I had put God first before him, before our relationship and before our marriage. And David began to soften up, and he wanted to know things about the Lord. And he would come and ask me, of all people, you know, about him. And we started seeing through some very miraculous things that God was restoring our marriage and putting us back together. We went to see David Youth. David was gloriously saved with me in the room. It was just really neat how the Lord orchestrated that I actually got to end up being in the room when he gave his heart to Christ. And that was in February of 2001. And so we started making plans to remarry. And when David found out, I brought to his attention these verses They were given to me on April 20th, 1991, a year and a half after he had left us. He was just amazed to know that I would still be praying for him. But, I mean, that's what you do when you love somebody. You don't give up, you know, no matter what they've done to you. You don't give up because, you know, God has a plan for them and God has a purpose for them. So when he saw these scriptures and he saw that I'd been praying and it had right on there, David's salvation, he decided that this was when he wanted us to be remarried. It was on April 20th. And I revisited the verse in Isaiah that said, I am the Lord, in its time I will do this swiftly. This was 12 years after David had left, 10 years after those verses, those promises, and those verses God had given me. And I just kind of laughed and I said, well, your swiftly is not the same as my swiftly, because 12 years, you know, 10 years from the, that's pretty long time in my book. Of course, in eternity, that's nothing, a drop in the bucket. But he told me to reread that verse. And it's, in its time, I will do this swiftly. That was the key, was in its time. And if you're going through a hard time in your marriage, wait for the proper time. Wait for in its time. Wait for God's timing. We try to rush things. And I certainly, in my own flesh, I would have rushed this way before 12 years. I mean, I would never have thought when this all happened that it would be 12 years down the road to be seeing the culmination of God's promises and God's blessings and God's his faithfulness to us. He was so faithful to my children and I financially. He was faithful to us emotionally. You know, he sent everything that we needed. It wasn't always exactly when we thought we needed it or how we thought, but he always sent it perfectly what we needed. And David and I were remarried on April 20th, 2001, which was exactly 10 years from the date of these promises. We were remarried with this Bible out in the foyer, opened up to these promises, because this is God's story. It's not my story, and it's not David's story. We were just the instruments that he used. And I really fully believe that he did this so that it could be an encouragement to others. So others can have hope, and so that you can have a hope, and your children can have hope. And it may not happen the same way it happened with David and I, but the point of the story is God's faithfulness. That's the point. The point is that even when we mess up and when we make mistakes, he's still there, and he still loves us, and he's going to take care of us. And since David and I have remarried, does that mean that everything's been perfect and we've just, you know, just had a big kumbaya festival ever since? We haven't. We've been remarried now. We just celebrated our 16th time anniversary. And there's been some hard times. There's been some times when I had to wonder, well, did we really make the right decision to get, you know, getting back together? Was that us or was it God? But every time God shows us that, no, this was his plan. It's not easy. Marriage is not easy. Life is not easy. And we just have to stay grounded in him. And we have to make decisions. We have to make decisions to say, I'm sorry. And decisions to say, will you forgive me? Because I'm the one that messed up. Because we all mess up. And wives, respect your husbands. If you're not showing your husbands respect, it really is true. It leaves a huge hole in their heart when they're not being respected. Does that mean respect them whenever they are being good? Yes, but it means respect them when they're not being so good too. Just, you can always find something in their life that you can respect them with. Compliment them in front of other people. Compliment them in front of other people when they're not there, because trust me, it'll get back. Because those people will look at your husband in a totally different way when they know that their wife is speaking well of him. Don't criticize your husband in front of other people. That's very detrimental. It's very hurtful. It's hurtful to all of us, but especially to men. Men, or any men watching this, love your wives. We need to be loved. We mess up. You know, we scream and yell sometimes, and we act ugly, and we're snippy, and we don't mean to, but just love us. Love us anyway. Love us as Christ loved the church, the way he said. And I would just encourage anyone out there that's having a hard time to just remember that none of us are perfect. We're all broken. We all bring something bad to the table, but we bring good things to the table too. No matter how bad your husband is, he brings good things to the table. Your children bring good things to the table. So I would just encourage anyone to just love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And to love your husband or your wife next. Put that relationship with God first. Put all relationships first. And then church work is good, and we need church work, and we need to be out there. And I'm all about, I'm still busy. Do I get it perfect all the time? No, I still struggle with that. That's a big struggle of mine because I just won't have my hand in every piece of the pie. But I have to learn to say no. There's times, you know, people at my church, they know when there's something going on. The first thing they ask me is David off that night? Because they know that if he's going to be home, then I'm not going. I'm going to be home with my husband. I'm going to honor him. I'm going to honor my time with him first. And it's not something that he demands of me or he can ask of me, but it's something I choose to do. So put your marriage above all else. Put your marriage above the children, above your work, above other things, and always submit your marriage to Christ and pray for one another and serve one another. And I just would pray a very special blessing on anybody that hears this. I just ask right now that the Lord would bless you, that the Lord would give you strength, he would give you wisdom, he would give you discernment, and he would give you love for one another. And thank you for this time, and I just pray that even one person will be helped. Thank you so much.